So I am obsessed with the problem of consciousness. My topic is a brief history of the study of consciousness. And we take it for granted, can you see my cursor there? When we open our eyes, the world out there appears inside our head, and Bing is meant to imply conscious awareness, phenomenal experience, what Peter called the hard problem, having subjective awareness of some sort. And it's approached through neuroscientists, roboticists, artists, physicists, psychiatrists, anesthesiologists, looks a little like me for some reason, meditators, and philosophers. Now, let's start with a simple question. When did consciousness arise? Peter alluded to this. Here we see a history of the universe, and some people would say that consciousness appeared in biology fairly recently with the advent of tools and language in the last couple hundred thousand years. Some would say that it occurred with the advent of animal life, eukaryotes, 450 million years ago. Some would say many billions of years ago, and some would say before the universe began. And not only Eastern philosophers say this, but Colin McGinn and some Western philosophers would say that. And Roger Penrose would say that because he thinks there are serial Big Bangs, and there was another eon before the Big Bang. But let's just take one aspect of this question and ask which came first, consciousness or life? Now, as Peter said, most neuroscientists, psychologists, Western philosophers would say, life gave rise to consciousness. Consciousness emerged from living systems, in particular, complex computation in the brain. However, panpsychists, as he said, Eastern philosophers, spiritualists, Whitehead would say consciousness is intrinsic to the universe and preceded life. It was there all along. And it preceded life, it was there all along. And if that were the case, perhaps life evolved and originated in order to access consciousness, to take advantage of consciousness, to feel good in some sense. And we'll come back to that. Now, in Western philosophy, the world out there is all in our head. Peter was talking about this, that Plato saw the tree, it was actually an image in his head, Bing is in his head, and he realized that the world out there was all in his head, and he didn't really know what was out there, as Peter was saying. And he used this allegory of Plato's cave, where the troglodytes only saw two-dimensional shadows and they assumed that was all there was to reality. And for them, two dimensions was pretty cool. They didn't realize there were three dimensions of space, and some people take this to mean there's more to reality than we perceive, and I think that's undoubtedly true in some sense. Descartes thought the same thing, cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am, and he remarked that we don't really know what's out there. We could each be a brain in a vat fed information by an evil genius. So here's this brain in a vat. I'm walking outside in the sun, bing. And so that means that consciousness and reality may both be an illusion. Now, on the other hand, in Eastern philosophy, consciousness pervades a deeper level of reality. Bing is everywhere. We're like awash in a sea of consciousness. And Atman from Brahman, and it gets organized in such a way, and we have self-consciousness. And that's a pretty solid approach. Now, in modern science, the brain is seen as a neuronal synaptic computer. On the left, we see a bunch of neurons connected by synapses, and on the right, we see a computer network, and people have assumed for many years that the brain is a computer, neurons are bits and switches, or synapses are switches, and furthermore, according to brain mapping, if we map every connection, every neuron, every synapse, and recreate it in a computer, we'll have the equivalence of the brain, and we can download our consciousness if we pay a couple hundred billion dollars and live forever or be conscious in some kind of artificial medium, freeze your brain now and wake up later and all that kind of stuff. Well, somebody got wise and said, well, before we worry about a brain or even a mouse, let's try a simple system like a worm, C. elegans, because every neuron, every synapse in C. elegans is known. It was mapped 10 or 15 years ago. So they put it into a computer and a big fanfare, and then the day came and they pressed the button and nothing happened. The worm didn't move. It just kind of lay there like nothing. And so there's something missing. Now let's take a simpler system, like a paramecium. This is one cell. It doesn't have any synapses. It doesn't have any connections. And it swims around. It bounces off an object. And it can learn. If you suck it into a capillary tube, it escapes faster each time. It avoids predators. It finds food. It finds a mate. And it has sex. And in fact, there's a X-rated image on the far right of two blue movies, two paramecium fuse during sex, the only time they're absolutely still, by the way, which is also interesting. And we don't know if they're conscious, but it does seem to me that the pleasure involved in reproduction might be the biggest drive there is to reproduce in evolution, at least in simpler organisms, maybe some of us too. Now, how is the paramecium so much more clever than a worm with 302 neurons? Well, it uses structures called cilia. So here's a paramecium. It's got this hair-like projections called cilia, which are also in our lungs, in our GI tract, everywhere, which are made of doublets of these structures called microtubules, and the cilium sticks out from the cell, and it's both a sensor and a motor, so it bends back and forth, and that's how the paramecium gets around and swims. And this is a centriole, which is what organizes cell division and mitosis, and it's very important in preventing cancer and that sort of thing. And it's made of microtubules also. Now, the cilia bends. How does the cilia bend? Well, I'll show you. It bends in the following way, that these microtubules shown here have these motor proteins that contract. They use ATP and they bend like arms, and they cause the whole cilia to bend back and forth, and the guy and the paramecium swims around. And if it runs into something, it bends the cilium, and that causes a signal to go inside the paramecium, and it knows what to do and where to go. Okay, cut to the brain. What does this have to do with the brain and us? Well, it turns out this exact same system of a dynein motor protein on a microtubule is used inside our brain neurons. So here's a neuron. This is the cell body, an axon, multiple dendrites. And inside this particular dendrite, we see the structure of the microtubule, and dynein moving along, conveying cargo to a synapse that may be out here. So it's stuff is synthesized here and has to be transported by these motor proteins moving along the microtubule to get delivered to a particular synapse. So it has to make a left turn, a right turn. It has to know where it's going. How does it do that? It turns out that these proteins called tau, which are important in Alzheimer's disease, which I'll get to in a second, are traffic signals. And they tell the kinesin where to get off. They tell the dynein where to get off to deliver a particular cargo and a precursor of a synaptic protein to a particular synapse. And this is synaptic plasticity. This is learning. This is memory. It's by coding tau at particular locations on a microtubule. So in Alzheimer's disease, there's amyloid plaques outside the neurons, but inside the neurons, what does the damage is that the tau protein falls off and the microtubule destabilizes and disassembles. And here's a paper that Deepak is a co-author on, along with Rudy Tanzi. There he is. Alzheimer's expert at Harvard, where we made the link between amyloid plaques and microtubule stability via zinc. But the point here is that microtubules destabilize, tau falls off, and you lose memory function. It's not the amyloid plaques, it's what's happening inside the neuron that caused the problem. So in Alzheimer's disease, we have these kinky neurons because the microtubules are all messed up. The microtubules disintegrate, the tau falls off, and you have these neurofibrillary tangles. This also occurs with too many anesthetics if you're very young, very old. So the problem in Alzheimer's appears to be, from the cognitive standpoint, we lose the function of the microtubules and the tau signaling. Okay, we'll come back to that. Let's back up and look at the entire brain, the whole brain. So here's Plato again, and a visual input enters his eye, and it goes to the thalamus, and from there, there's three steps. So remember a three-step pathway. One, it goes to primary visual cortex, but that's not conscious. Christoph Koch showed that years ago. Then the signal is sent to the front of the brain in a feed-forward mechanism, but that's not conscious either. Then there's a third wave that projects from the prefrontal cortex to various areas, and that's conscious. The third wave is conscious. It takes a couple hundred milliseconds and correlates with gamma synchrony EEG. In philosophy, this is the basis for what's called higher order thought theory. Philosophers Rosenthal and Gennaro, for example. The third wave is also physiologically associated with consciousness through the work of Victor Lamé, and pharmacologically because anesthetics, all types of anesthetics, erase consciousness specifically by acting on the third wave and have no effect on the first and second waves. In fact, we use the first and second waves to evoke potentials to monitor spine integrity under anesthesia, but the patients are unconscious. So the brain's active. The only thing that's affected is this third wave. Now, why is that? What the heck is happening? Well, once we get to the cortex, there's also three waves. The inputs come to layer 4, they go to layer 1, 2, 3, and 6, and then they converge on these giant pyramidal cells in layer 5. So this is kind of the confluence of the information leading to consciousness. And this is apparently where consciousness occurs, in these giant pyramidal cells in layer 5. So they could occur elsewhere, but this is the most likely place. Now, if we look inside the giant pyramidal cell, we see those same microtubules. And there is this very interesting mixed polarity network, where instead of being continuous, as they are in axons and all other cells, they're broken up. So not good for structural support, but good for information processing. And it seems likely that consciousness occurs in end of integration in giant pyramidal cells. These apical dendrites rise to the surface and give rise to EEG. So if you're doing EEG biofeedback or whatever, it's due to these pyramidal cells and their apical dendrites. So that here's a microtubule, and it's a peanut. It's a hollow cylinder made up of peanut-shaped proteins called tubulin. And I first got interested in them when I was in medical school studying cancer, looking at mitosis and how abnormal mitosis could lead to abnormal genotypes and cancer. And the theory of cancer that's actually making a comeback now is that it's due to abnormal mitosis. So computers were new, and it was discovered that the microtubules were in neurons. So I began to think that microtubules were computers and modeled them as cellular automata. This is something called the game of life. And we see patterns moving along microtubules that can process information. So microtubules are essentially, potentially, computers that can store a lot of information inside the cell. They can run the cilium for the paramecium, and they can store memory and perform consciousness, perhaps, inside our brains. So and store memory. So memory is still a mystery. People say that it's due to synaptic plasticity, that in this LTP, long-term potentiation, where you stimulate this neuron, and this neuron, the synapse stays hypersensitive for a long time. Calcium comes in, but these proteins last hours to days, and memories can last lifetimes. So memory needs to be at a deeper level. And one of the things that happens when calcium comes in is that this enzyme, CAMK2, is activated and phosphorylates something inside the neuron to encode memory. So I got interested in this, and it turns out that CAMK2 is this really beautiful-looking snowflake-looking enzyme that's hexagonal. This is looking down on it, and this is looking at it from the side. Now, when calcium comes in inside the cell, it activates the CAMK2. And it sends out six arms or legs, depending on how you want to look at it, into this thing that somebody called a nanopoodle. It's a nanoscale device. It kind of looks like a poodle. And these sites here are phosphorylation sites to encode memory. So I asked myself, well, what could CAMK2 be phosphorylating inside the neuron to store information? And I go, well, microtubules. Microtubules have hexagonal lattices, and they're hello. Look to be roughly the same size. So I got with my colleagues, Travis Craddock and Jack Tusinski, and we showed in this paper in PLOS Computational Biology that the CAMK2 matches perfectly over the microtubule lattice here and here, and that memory is likely to be encoded by this nanopoodle landing on the microtubule, encoding memory, and then going on its merry way. And this is a way to store information. And we also know that the microtubules in the centrioles, this should be, convey epigenetic memory. It used to be thought that things passed on from generation to generation could only occur through the genes. Now we know a lot, and Deepak's been doing a lot of work on this, epigenetic memory, and it turns out that it's probably stored in these centrioles, which are at the core of the cytoskeleton in every cell. Okay, so through about the 1980s, I spent a lot of time modeling microtubules as classical information devices, and then later with Roger Penrose as quantum devices. And I was going around to a lot of artificial intelligence meetings, singularity types, who were claiming that, for example, to reach brain equivalence in a computer, there were 10 to the 11th neurons in the brain, about 1,000 synapses per neuron, 100 hertz operation cycles, giving 10 to the 16th operations per second per brain. So Ray Kurzweil and all these guys are saying, well, as soon as we get a computer that can do 10 to the 16th operations per second, we'll have brain equivalence, consciousness, pace a couple hundred billion, you can download your consciousness into a computer, live forever, and we'll take care of you. And I was going around saying, no, that's ridiculous. You can't explain, well, at that now we know you can't explain a worm that way. And you needed to go to the microtubule level, in which you have 10 to the 11th neurons per brain, 10 to the 9th tubulins per neuron, 10 to the 7th hertz, megahertz, giving you 10 to the 16th operations per second per neuron, or 10 to the 27th operations per second per brain. So they didn't like that very much, the AI types. because it pushed their goalposts way, way, way downstream. They said, get out of here, kid, you bother me. And so I became unpopular among AI types, and still am, apparently. But then one day somebody said, okay, wise guy, let's say you're right, and you have all this information processing in microtubules. How the heck does that explain consciousness? Love, joy, feelings, emotions, all that kind of stuff, the hard problem. And I had to admit they were right. I had become a reductionist, and I didn't like that. I had a long look in the mirror, and I was kind of stunned. I said, this can't be right. But fortunately, this guy suggested, and I can't remember who it was, suggested I read a book by Roger Penrose involving quantum physics. And you might also say, where's the Bing? But also, isn't the brain just a receiver? And I think that's a sentiment that's probably in this room. But either way, you have to explain the hard problem. So I read this book, The Emperor's New Mind by Roger Penrose, and he argued against computation as an explanation for consciousness, that consciousness required understanding. A computer might beat you in chess, but it doesn't really understand anything. It's all brute force. And that what was missing was something from quantum physics, a collapse of the wave function. And I was kind of blown away by that because I'd never thought about that. And it's still kind of mind-boggling to make that leap. But as Roger later said, if you eliminate the impossible, whatever's left must be correct, even if it's seemingly improbable, which I found out later he got from Sherlock Holmes. So one thing I learned, I dived into the quantum business, and nobody really understands quantum physics. But basically, we can say that the world is divided into two realms, the quantum and the classical. In the classical, everything's localized, everything's definite, everything's in one place. In the quantum world, things can be in multiple places at the same time, in superposition, non-local, connected over distance, wave-like, and small. Now, why don't we see these superpositions in our real world? And there's a number of potential solutions. One is that conscious observation causes collapse. This was put forth by Wigner, von Neumann, Henry Stapp, who'll speak here tomorrow, is truly a pioneer in this area. Lately, David Chalmers has been jumping on this bandwagon. And Schrodinger thought this was ridiculous and came up with his thought experiment of Schrodinger's cat, where you have a quantum particle out here that is both can both enter the box and not enter the box, releases the poison, kills the cat, and doesn't kill the cat because it both enters and doesn't enter, until you open the box and look at it. And Schrodinger came up with this as an example of how ridiculous and absurd this was, but there's still no better explanation, or nothing has really proven it wrong. And in fact, Dean Radin up at IONS has been doing similar experiments with a double slit experiment. And another explanation is decoherence, that any interaction between a quantum system and the classical world disrupts it, but no quantum state is truly isolated. And a third possibility is multiple worlds, where every superposition possibility branches off to form its own reality. There's no collapse, and you have multiple infinite universes overlapping. And despite how absurd this is, a lot of people take it seriously, and it's untestable, but it's the most popular explanation among physicists, kind of like Donald Trump is the most popular choice among Republicans. Absurd and untestable. But then along came Roger Penrose with his idea. He said that, number one, he said basically collapse causes consciousness. Consciousness doesn't cause collapse, because when you say that, you become a dualist and you put consciousness outside of science. He said a number of important things. Understanding is more than computation. It involves self-collapse of the quantum wave function. And superposition is separation in reality, like the multiple worlds. But that these separations are unstable and will collapse at a time given by a simple equation, E equals H over T. And each such objective reduction event is accompanied by a subjective experience, bang, a moment of conscious experience. And the kicker was that the choices, if you're mindful and conscious, the choices are not random, but influenced by what he called Platonic values embedded in space-time geometry. Like your choices resonate with the structure of the universe. This could be mathematical truth, aesthetic values, ethical values, what have you. And so basically he was saying that consciousness is a process in the structure of the universe, ripples in the very structure of space-time geometry. Now, how could particles exist in superposition in two or more places? And Peter mentioned Einstein's general relativity, where he equated a particle location with a particular curvature. So here we've just taken one dimension of space and one dimension of time, so we can have a two-dimensional space-time sheet. And if the particle moves, say from here back and forth, It's actually the curvature that's oscillating back and forth. And if we have superposition of the particle being in both places, then it's actually a separation in space-time geometry. The universe itself kind of shreds, begins to separate. Now, if this were to continue, you'd have the multiple worlds hypothesis with a universe here and a universe here. But Penrose said, no, these are unstable. And this superposition will evolve only till reaching a threshold given by E equals H over T, where E is the amount of superposition, and H is Planck's constant, and T the time at which this will occur. And the kicker, bing, consciousness happens with this collapse. Consciousness is produced by each and every collapse, which is a self-collapse, as a function of the universe. So this means the qualia could be sort of particular patterns in space-time geometry that are collapsed to. So the redness of the rose, the qualia of the redness of the rose, conventional explanations would say due to a pattern of brain activity, but we would say it's a pattern in space-time geometry, more than just three curves, which is reproduced in her head. So redness is a particular pattern in space-time geometry. So that's our approach to qualia and how we explain the hard problem. So, but Penrose didn't have a quantum computer in the brain. He had a mechanism for consciousness, the first and only mechanism ever put forth, but he didn't have a quantum computer in the brain. I had microtubules, which I thought could be quantum computers, so I had a structure, he had the mechanism. We teamed up and developed a theory called ORCOR, and here we are back in 1994 at the Grand Canyon. After the first Tucson conference, there's Roger, there's me about to fall in. That's his wife, there's Jeff Tollickson, some of you know him, Amos, Seamus, and there's Dave Chalmers, and a few other people. And we developed a model that I'll just briefly describe, where there's quantum dipoles traveling around the microtubule, and you could have the dipole pointing up or down or superposition of both. So this is what's called a quantum bit or a qubit in quantum computing, where you have both possibilities that collapse to one or the other. So when it collapses to one or the other, that's the solution to the quantum computer, for the quantum computer. So this would be happening in microtubules that reach threshold, conscious now, bing, because it's all connected to space-time geometry. And then you can have a sequence of these events, bing, 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 at say 40 hertz EEG time, which require about 20 billion tubulins. Now, everybody said, you guys are crazy because everybody knows the brain is too warm, wet, and noisy for delicate quantum effects, but a couple experiments proved them wrong. If you do quantum spin through these benzene rings, which are the basis for all organic chemistry, you get quantum spin transfer, which is increased by temperature. And then it was discovered that photosynthesis in plants collects photons and transports the energy through multiple possible pathways simultaneously, superposition of all pathways by these pi resonance rings, the same as in the Ouyang experiment. So this brings us to organic chemistry. So I'm going to give you a six-month course in organic chemistry in one slide, where we have chains of hydrocarbons, alkanes, and then if you add a double bond, you get alkenes. And chemists in the 17th century knew this. But then they had this benzene, which was C6H6, which didn't fit the formula. And Kekulé had a dream that these were snakes, and one snake swallowed his tail and said, benzene is a ring, and he was right. And it's a ring sharing with three extra double bonds, which delocalized to give a delocalized electron cloud, pi resonance. And we know that this type of medium, this oily benzene-like medium, is where consciousness comes from. And we know that because anesthetics act in these regions to reversibly erase consciousness. These two guys, Meyer and Overton, a little over 100 years ago, studied all these gases which had anesthetic effects. They worked on all animals at the same concentration, takes the same amount to put you to sleep as a cockroach or a salamander or a fruit fly, the same concentration, and they have relative potencies, and they found that their potency over many, many orders of magnitude was related to their solubility in olive oil, in the same pi resonance oil-like molecules that are the basis for organic chemistry. And if you took a body and imagine somebody you don't like and you want to grind them up into solubility compartments and see where the anesthetics bind, they bind here in this highly nonpolar region, which is very much like benzene. Okay, so where are these pi resonances in the brain that mediate consciousness? And we think they're in the structure of the microtubule protein tubulin, and Travis Craddock and I and Jack Tuzinski modeled tubulin and showed 32 of these pi resonance groups from tryptophan, phenylalanine, and tyrosine, and came up with this idea that inside neurons, there's these microtubules, they have these oscillating dipoles that can oscillate back and forth, go into superposition, and when anesthesia comes along, it blocks them, blocks the dipoles, you go to sleep, surgeon cuts you open, you don't care. And we blow off the gas at the end and you wake up. So this appears to be how anesthesia works. Okay, this is all theory. And then we got some evidence for this from our friend Anirban Bandyopadhyay, some of you know him, who liked our model, and he took one microtubule and did nanotechnology and put four different nano electrodes on them, and two to stimulate, two to record, and they're good insulators, but when you stimulated with an alternating current at different frequencies, they became conductive. The resistance dropped and became highly conductive at, say, 10 megahertz, 20 megahertz, and also in the kilohertz range. And this was at room temperature, and he showed these were quantum effects. And then he used 2 megahertz to stimulate the assembly of microtubules, and he found that 2 megahertz was the sweet spot to make microtubules grow. So remember, microtubules fall apart in Alzheimer's disease, so this might be useful, right? So he then went to MIT and spent a year looking at the same thing inside neurons with these nanoprobes and found something very interesting. He found a sequence of frequencies from terahertz to gigahertz to megahertz down into the EEG range, all from microtubule vibrations. And in one case, he put from the electrode inside, he recorded music or recorded sound. So hopefully this is going to play. This is the sound of microtubules inside a neuron singing. Takes about a minute and a half. So you can see here he's sweeping the frequency. This is down converted because it would be too fast to actually hear. So this gives the idea that there are vibrational resonances going on inside neurons due to the microtubule. So these are measuring from the microtubule bundles inside neurons, and these triplets occur every several orders of magnitude. Now the high-pitched one. Hang on. I'm not sure what this really means, but it's kind of nice, and a lot of people really like it. But it's basically what's going on inside our neurons all the time due to these vibrational resonances. And one point I want to make is that consciousness is more like music than computation. Okay. So that's going on in the microtubules, which is actually connected to space-time geometry. Let me just go back to this one. So what happens if you go higher frequency, beyond the frequency here, and you get in more and more into quantum, and you become more and more non-local? And what that could mean is that consciousness goes into a deeper level, finer scale level of space-time geometry. And for example, Bing could go, so here's our scale, and we're going smaller, smaller, and smaller down to the Planck scale, that in altered states, meditative states, psychedelic states, and the psychedelic drugs push the system more into quantum non-locality, that consciousness goes to a deeper level in the structure of reality, which is kind of fractal-like. Or as the Beatles sang, the deeper you go, the higher you fly, the deeper you go. And I think this is probably true, and actually Deepak wrote and I wrote an article about this as a possible mechanism for out-of-body experiences, and possibly even afterlife, as a speculative suggestion. So far, consciousness occurs only in living systems, and we don't really know what life is. But and evolution, I've always been a little suspicious about some aspects of evolution, because Darwin's theory fails to account for the origin of life. How did we get from nothing to genes, to DNA? The motivation for selfish genes, reproductive success, but if there's no feeling, why are you going to bother to reproduce? And we know that behavior, our behavior, animal behavior, every type of behavior we can measure, is driven by reward and pleasure, by feelings, and particularly dopamine, dopaminergic reward and pleasure, This could be hedonism, Freud's pleasure principle, altruism, it feels better to give than to receive, spiritual harmony, resonance with the universe. These all feel good. This is what drives our behavior. That's why you're all here. That's why I'm here. We want to understand, and that makes us feel good. In other words, without feelings in evolution, why bother? So life apparently began in a primordial soup, which was proposed in the 1920s by Operin and Haldane, a simmering mix from which biomolecules emerged 3 to 4 billion years later. And this was simulated by Stanley Miller and Harold Urey at University of Oregon in the 1950s. And they put all the stuff in that they knew was there. They added some the right gas, atmosphere, a little spark for lightning, and try to recreate the conditions of the primordial soup. And what they found were organic amphipathic molecules. Now, an amphipathic molecule has our pi resonance group that we talked about before, a nonpolar and then a polar tail. And this is very similar to the structure of dopamine, by the way, the pleasure molecule, or all psychoactive molecules. They have nonpolar oil-like rings, pi resonance clouds on one end, and polar water-soluble tails on the other. Now, we know that oil and water don't mix, and what Operin said happens that these amphipathic molecules, the nonpolar groups would stick together, the polar groups would stick out into the water, and you'd have a nonpolar interior, kind of like a soap molecule, and we know oil and water don't mix, and this is a precursor of proteins, and which have nonpolar interiors and polar exteriors. It's also the basic mechanism for structure of lipid bilayers, membranes, nucleic acids. They all have this nonpolar interior and polar exterior. And we also know that the nonpolar groups are extremely important for psychoactive molecules, the neurotransmitters dopamine, serotonin. All the psychedelics have complex pi resonance groups. And they, I would say, push the system more into quantum state, more quantum resonances, more non-locality, deeper into faster frequency conscious events, and deeper into the fundamental level of space-time geometry. Okay, back in the primordial soup, what Roger and I are suggesting in our most recent paper is that these micelles formed, and they started to entangle and build up their superposition by E equals H over T, and at some point in the development, reached threshold of a conscious moment, bing, and collapsed, and this correlated with what was happening in space-time geometry. So this could have happened in the primordial soup. Now, most of these, initially, would be random, but occasionally, some might be positive and feel good. If they got them aligned just the right way, these simple protocells, my cells, might have pleasurable feelings. And this could have allowed feedback, since there's only certain geometric arrangements of these pi resins called pi stacks, and certain sequences gave positive protoconscious OR feelings, providing feedback for biological structure to optimize pleasure. And I'm trying to challenge the dogma in evolution to say that actually it was pleasure due to this mechanism and feelings that drove evolution, not the need to promulgate genes, because who would that need before? I mean, there's no agency there. So I'm calling this the quantum pleasure principle and suggesting that consciousness, thank you, or quantum hedonism, which do you like? I can get a vote later. That consciousness preceded life, or simple consciousness, maybe proto-consciousness, feelings were there all along, were in the universe, and drove the origin and evolution of life. Okay, so let me wrap up with one final area. That is to say that if brain microtubules resonate in megahertz to give consciousness, could mental and cognitive disorders be treated by applying megahertz vibrations to the brain? Okay, what am I talking about? So we know these various non-invasive brain stimulation techniques, transcranial magnetic stimulation, transcranial electrical stimulation, and they sort of work, they sort of do something, but we don't know what. We don't know how they work. And then there's also ultrasound, mechanical vibrations, which is in megahertz. And ultrasound is mechanical vibrations above audible hearing, from 20 kilohertz out to several hundred megahertz. This actually spells out sound. And this has been around for a long time in medicine. It's used for imaging, as you know, to see the fetus in the utero, to see all kinds of organs. We use it to find the jugular vein or nerves to block. So we're quite familiar with this. So when I learned this, microtubules have megahertz vibrations. Ultrasound is megahertz. They're putting electrical and magnetic. What about ultrasound? So I found out easily that this guy, Jamie Tyler, who was at Arizona State University, pioneered transcranial ultrasound, putting it into animals, and finding behavioral and electrophysiological effects, later cognitive improvement, and suggested it might be useful for brain treatments. He started a company, NeuroTrek and Think, and now they're mostly focusing on electrical stimulation, but they also have an ultrasound device. So here's their U+ ultrasound headset from Think, Inc., and apparently they've raised $13 million to change your mood with ultrasound waves and electricity. And as you can see, if you put one of these devices on, you immediately get sexy and beautiful. However, then there's me. And I was telling my anesthesia colleagues, I said, you know, we should try this on our chronic pain patients. They're depressed. We'll give them some ultrasound, see if they get better. And they said, no, we don't try anything on anybody unless we try it ourselves. First, you got a shaved head. It's your idea. You go first. And so one day at the end of a busy day in the operating room, we're sitting around the library. I said, okay, I'll try it. So I took the ultrasound device. I put some goop on it because you need a contact. I held it in my head for about 15 seconds. I didn't feel a damn thing. I didn't feel it. I put it down. I made sure the machine was on. I said, well, that's too bad. That's not going to work. And about a minute later, I started to get a buzz. And I was kind of high for an hour from 15 seconds or so. And so we did a study on chronic pain patients. We got it through our IRB and published the first study of transcranial ultrasound on mental states in brain stimulation. Since then, we've done a couple other, and 15 seconds to frontotemporal here gives about 40 minutes or more, and there, quite literally, is my brain on ultrasound. This is the imaging device. You don't need imaging to treat, but this one happened to have it. So we've done another study where we showed, for example, that 30 seconds waveform A is better than 10 minutes. You don't want to do too much because it'll heat the brain, and we want low intensity, subthermal, and just on briefly, then off, on, off. So we avoid, because high intensity is actually used to cause lesions, to zap tumors or seizure foci. So we're very concerned with low intensity, just briefly. And we also looked at vertex stimulation, and the overall mood didn't change, but some subjects had uncontrolled laughter, increased mindfulness by non-attachment scale, and out-of-body experiences. So, in fact, the ones who were laughing, we said, should we stop? They said, no, don't stop. So, but some people didn't like it. And we found out later, and I'll show you in a minute why we think that happened. So we also showed that 2 megahertz versus, this is with the GE device, General Electric, 2 megahertz is much better than placebo. And we showed that the ultrasound gets across to the other side of the brain. And at the vertex, we get the anterior cingulate, which is a big emotional center. So that's probably the laughter and the out-of-body experiences and so forth. Okay, so I mentioned the possible relation to Alzheimer's. And this study came out from Australia early this year, where they had a mouse model of Alzheimer's, genetically induced Alzheimer's. And they were using ultrasound to open the blood-brain barrier to get these drugs across. They were testing for Alzheimer's. And they found that a control group that got the ultrasound and no drug got better. Their amyloid plaques went away, and their memory improved by these memory tests. And they concluded that, and the plaques went away because they activated the microglia, probably by stimulating the microtubules. They went inside and gobbled up the plaques. So they suggested that this should be explored further as a non-invasive method for Alzheimer's disease, but that it would take several years to figure out the safety. And I wrote to them and I said, hey, we've been doing this for a couple of years now, and so we're going ahead and starting a study on Alzheimer's. And so I mentioned because we think we're stimulating microtubules, which are unstable in Alzheimer's disease. I showed the 2 megahertz electrical, but they're piezoelectric, so it probably doesn't matter. Promotes the stability of microtubules and the sweet spot being about 2 megahertz, which is what we're using. My colleague Sadviki Gupta showed that microtubules, you assemble them and then they disassemble, but if you give them ultrasound, they stay assembled, so it does seem to stabilize them. And then finally, another student of ours, Uma Rahman, looked at cortical embryonic neurons, and these guys over here, got ultrasound, and they have many more neurites. So they're sprouting axons and dendrites already. So we think that this may be useful in brain injury, Alzheimer's, and pediatric developmental delay, and depression as well. So we're just starting these studies. We have a number of devices. This is one that was built by a friend of mine in Berkeley, who started a company, Berkeley Ultrasound, and he just got bought out by the Chinese and moved to Shenzhen, and he'll be bringing this device over to us in November, and we'll be using it in our study. So I think that's a very promising tool. It's painless, it's safe, it's cheap, so the drug companies will probably assassinate us at some point, but what the heck. So let me conclude and say that 3 points, that consciousness is a process in the structure of the universe, which I think bridges kind of Western science with non-duality, or actually is non-duality, connected to the brain by quantum computations in microtubules, which explains how we're all different. We are conscious, but we have different consciousness because we have different microtubules, different memory. Number two, that OR-based, objective reduction-based primitive feelings, proto-conscious feelings, present in the universe may have prompted the origin of life and driven its evolution. Life evolved to feel good. Now, this is another heresy. I kind of get in trouble with a lot of people because I'm challenging Dawkins and Shermer and all these evolutionary guys, Dan Dennett, and we're arguing back and forth about this. And I'm sticking to my guns. I really am suspicious that selfish gene idea is bogus, and that there's some kind of primitive feelings driving evolution and actually was the spark of life back in the primordial soup, something like that. And finally, that resonating brain microtubules with transcranial ultrasound, TUS, which is also the airport code for Tucson, since I live in Tucson, can safely and painlessly improve mood and offers promise for Alzheimer's disease, traumatic brain injury, and other disorders. And finally, let me conclude by mentioning, and Maurizio was kind enough to mention, the science of consciousness. We've dropped, it used to be toward a science of consciousness, and after 20 years, we decided to drop the torta. We got a lot of crap about that. Thank you. And so the first The Science of Consciousness, the 22nd annual conference, will be in Tucson at the Ventana Canyon Resort. And you can see the brain constellation that the cactus, these are kind of like electrodes probing the brain, right? And we have a really great lineup. Deepak and many, many others will be there. And you can find out about it at this website. So thank you very much. You've been a great audience. I appreciate it very much.